marketing background. So that's my first question. If anybody wants to share, just at least initial thoughts on what, you know, how they took that, or
So if you think about it, the big picture kind of competition that's happening, right, is if you've got Apple with hardware and software sort of providing a window into delivery of content. Same thing with Google. You can see that the announcement of having the App Store on BlackBerry and launching the phone, it's the same. Amazon is trying to create that same experience, right? And the screen becomes just a shopping window. And so the analogy I think of is where you now have deep linking into apps. The Amazon experience allows you to sort of click on an advertisement and go directly into something and buy it, right? And if search results become visible in Google, then the search experience, again, becomes directly shopping. So it's all sort of going down this path of making the screen a window into just one huge store.
What's interesting is I think as early as this week I was discussing, and a lot of the search experts on the website were complaining that with mobile rising, you know, their business was not doing really well because search traditionally in user acquisition haven't worked really well on mobile to generate volume or even quality. And so I think that's a big opportunity, at least for a segment of the SEO and SEM wizards, to actually port their experience over to mobile if Google is opening that.
You kind of touched on it, and I was going to wait till later, but I want to jump over to it. Let's talk about Fire Phone, let's talk about the Amazon App Store, and more importantly, the Amazon App Store and BlackBerry coming together on this big partnership. That was major news as of last week. Let's talk about, you know, initial thoughts from all of that.
For you first,
No, I mean, I think it's only natural for BlackBerry to want to do something like that, right? I mean, BlackBerry is struggling, and a partnership like that is trying to save the business. So I think it was obviously a great idea on BlackBerry's part, and interested to see how it works out. You know, I think BlackBerry has a ways to go to improve the hardware, so enabling the Amazon marketplace and the App Store into BlackBerry phones is one step. Let's see where they go from here. It's my personal opinion on this.
I think Amazon is really exciting because they haven't been able to do too much in games yet, and I feel like if they're going to put their focus into games, they could be very disruptive. They have a lot of engagement with users, and I think with this sort of partnership, it'll allow us to have better engagement with our fans and give people the bigger opportunity to have choice of platforms. Because right now it's two players, kind of fun to bring somebody else into the mix and see what happens. Love a little competition. So I'm really excited about it, and I'm really excited about things Amazon can do. I've always had a really good working experience with Amazon at Halfbrick, and they've just been very aggressive, very pro-developer, always asking our feedback on what we want, what we think about features they're rolling out. So very engaging with developers, very developer-friendly. So to me, it's very exciting, and it's great to see them take a big step into games, and it's really exciting.
Well, I'm going to disagree with you on very aggressive. I think if you look at the phone announcement Amazon did, I think Amazon is great for some casual apps, but traditionally for hardcore, the only guys they signed was EA and like some very unknown apps. The features they were proposing are very gimmicky, and I think if you look around, you're like, I think Amazon, their main problem is they're investing heavily on their own content on the Amazon Prime platform, right? A few series, but if you compare the quality of Netflix, it's subpar. That they haven't been able to really get their, you know, House of Cards or a few like Orange is the New Black. And I think it's the same for gaming. They have signed a few big names, you know, including Halfbrick. But for the rest, I don't think they have nearly announced like a big fund, like $50-100 million fund that will really drive more content. And I think, especially in the hardcore side, I think they have nothing for hardcore gamers. So they have a great shopping platform, they have a great devices, but the content is really lacking, and I don't see any incentive if I think of a third platform, I'm thinking Windows Phone and Nokia is actually a more viable alternative if you want to do hardcore games, especially if you want to go into Asia.
You know, to your point, sorry, I agree with you, and I look at like who buys an Amazon device, right? So when I look at what games or what content succeeds there, I hear a lot of social casino games succeeding on Amazon. Oh, Amazon's great, we monetize really well there. Well, who plays social casinos? It's probably the same people that we would expect to buy a Kindle, right? It's middle-aged, probably women, mostly women. So as far as hardcore devices or hardcore content on Amazon, I think the demographic of who owns the devices needs to change a little bit before that becomes relevant.
For that, the price is the other concern, right? You announce a phone and you price it, if you don't go through AT&T at $200, you price it at almost $700. I don't think it's going to really appeal to the, you know, like 15 to 25 generation to have a $700 phone. And I think getting locked in with AT&T for 2 years is something that a lot of young generation especially don't want to do either. So I think there is a major pricing problem, and Xbox, Microsoft have learned that, you know, pricing issue could become really quickly a sales issue.
I think one of the bigger things that I saw is, especially from, you know, BlackBerry coming in and jumping in with Amazon, for the first time from an official standpoint, there's a major movement towards the third-party Android stores, which previously had been third-party. You had Google Play, and then you had the Amazon Store and GitJar and these others. And now, developers are in some ways flocking to the third-party, especially early stage developers and indie developers who are finding higher revenue per users on earlier stage stuff from Samsung, from Amazon, and then easier discoverability because you're talking about app stores that have 140,000 apps versus 1.4 million apps.
I mean, I think it's interesting from a strategic standpoint that there are several players in the market, at least some of us sitting on this panel, who are interested, right, in developing alternatives to the sort of Apple and Android dominance. So as a first step, right, sort of proving out the concept that this can work, I wouldn't be surprised if you see more of these happening, right? Whether it's on Tizen or anywhere else, Microsoft.
I mean, just as great, I think there is a great ecosystem and the two platform holder are doing a great job at it. There is a great reach, and if you look even in countries like China, where there is no Google, right? So there's a lot of third-party platform, you're seeing the amount of money we're getting from the App Store is incredible. And, you know, those guys are doing a great job there. If you're looking at a lot of other countries, such as Korea, because traditionally, right, Korea, if you go there and try to use Google Maps or a bunch of Yelp and so on, you actually can't use it. But yet, you know, like if you add Android, like Google Play Store, and if you add the App Store, you're getting 99% of the app revenue. So I'm just saying, if they were really doing something wrong, you will have way more of the revenue coming from the local Korean platform, but it's not the case.
So here's a question that I didn't think I was going to ask, but now I want to. Separate yourselves from your guys' companies. Let's say you're building a game, and it's just you. You guys are you're completely building it off of your own money. And it's an Android game. Which stores do you put it in, and why?
Well, I think the easy answer is every store you can.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you hit it dead on with some of the things about you know, in these other countries, especially Asia. I think SK Telecom, the store, is actually the biggest one in Korea, right? And certainly in China, that's a big issue, I think. What I've seen over years, actually, and this is shifting some, is that in the U.S., people tend to be really focused on the fact that, you know, there seem to be these kind of dominant players, and you're overlooking the fact that, you know, it's not tough to distribute from here around the world, and there's a lot of revenue opportunities for that. I mean, there are issues involved. Interesting thing, like in China, you know, it's like, how are you going to monetize in China remotely, something and I think that's obviously a really important one. And the thing there is, of course, that you want to go towards some of a model like advertising or in-app purchase. And one of the interesting things, actually, that was kind of a breakthrough with the in-app purchase is because there you're talking about actually kind of small amounts of money, so it's great you do a big scale, but you don't have to worry about the small transactions. So the ability to support actually really small transactions, which is happening, you know, is kind of critical. But, so then, you know, your biggest sort of barrier at that point is more localization issues and things like that. I mean, but you should clearly, I think, be trying to go to the markets. But there's some thought that you have to put into it.
Yeah, I mean, just an interesting fact about China, right? So we're Unity, and if you look at our market share in China compared to elsewhere, it's very small. However, there are thousands of developers in China using Unity, Unity Pro. It's just they're not officially using it. It's all been pirated. So there's probably more Unity developers using Unity in China than in the U.S., but far, far, far less paying for it.
Papaya Mobile is actually a Chinese company, so all of this stuff is pretty relevant to us. Not at all. I mean, what's interesting is that I think that the most recent numbers, sort of 40% of the mobile revenue and apps is coming from Asia Pacific, and China is very quickly becoming sort of on par with Japan and beyond. The complexity in the market is definitely still there. The general comment about whether having more app stores than less is a good thing or a bad thing, I actually think there's trade-offs there. So if you are a small app developer in China, you have a lot more opportunity to get your app featured in one of these many stores and sort of ratchet yourself up. Whereas in an oligopoly situation, I mean, let's face it, 99% of apps that get launched never see the light of day. And that, I would argue, is a problem with the system overall. But to pull it back to China, because I love the topic, we actually believe that this is going to be probably the leading growth area in mobile for the foreseeable future. We've made actually a really big bet on it by launching our own real-time bidding platform or exchange in China. It's actually the first of its kind. There's massive, and to the point about measuring attribution and making money, most of the advertising that's going to be happening on these exchanges is actually audience-based advertising. So if you're a publisher, you'll be making money on impressions rather than on conversions, which is, you know, where it's a much better way to sort of make money in that market.
Well, two things on the third-party app store. Having experience on the Samsung app store in, you know, old job, you know, we're getting 50,000-60,000 installed from the Google Play store and up to 10,000, which was nice, from the Samsung store in a day. The key problem was really the LTV of the users. I'll share the specifics, but the LTV of the Samsung store user was well lower than the Google Play LTV. So at the end of the day, knowing that you had to do some specific, you know, the icon wasn't the same, and you had to do a specific build and specific tracking, I know it was really, really challenging to decide to keep investing in a store that wasn't generating high LTV users. In a way, if you're a business owner, you do the same as a user acquisition manager. You look at the different channels, you look at the number of, you know, the number of hours it takes to be present in those channels, and you look at the value you're getting from those channels. And if the store users of store A versus store B are, you know, a lower quality, then ultimately at some point you decide that if the scale is lower and the quality is lower, it's probably not worth your time. So I will say, to your point, go in every store, check the quality of the user with your first game, or the Android store, and then just decide. It's the same in China. There is like 52, 53 markets who are commercially viable. But usually we do a staggered launch where we start with 7 games for a closed beta period, then we go into, we're a Chinese company, so we don't have the payment problem or the government approval problem, but then you go into 25, 30 store, and then only you deploy your game, like well later, 2 or 3 months after the full launch, you go into the 50 plus store, just because it takes time, and you know, you have to renegotiate the terms, and using the KPIs from store A and B will help you get a better rev share with store C. So, which is why you want to stagger your launch, you know, and you go in the big one, 360 and so on early on, and you keep the small one for later to say, hey, I don't need to be on your store, but if you give me a really good rev share, maybe I'm gonna go in your store. Because you don't have to forget Apple and Google 30%, you could forget about it in China, it's up to 60% rev share in the store are taking. Not if you have a big Chinese publisher though.
So I would say from our experience that if you were a developer and you wanted to get your games out there, you could probably do it on your own for the US market, but if you're gonna do it in China and Japan and Korea, it's really hard to do on your own. It's really important to have a local partner. See, even with our game, Fruit Ninja, it's really popular in China, but there's no way we would do it on our own. We've had a partner that's localized the game for us, and also a partner that notices that there's a whole bunch of pirated Fruit Ninjas out there, and they have the local know-how and contacts to get those games pulled immediately, because like, there goes all of our money, right, to this random other Fruit Ninja game. So I would say, depending on what markets you're trying to get into, know whether you should go it alone or know whether you should partner with somebody, and if you're gonna partner, really understand the reputation of that partner in these countries, because that's very important, transparency and being able to rely on somebody that you might give your source code to, extremely important. So I'd say, you know, obviously you want to get out to as many markets as possible, but do it in a thoughtful way. And do it relatively quickly, because if your game is a hit in the US, it'll already 2 days later there'll be a version of it in China. So like, get on it, you know, don't like wait around until everybody's already gone and played it and downloaded the fake version.
Well, the good story is if you look at the number one top grossing game today, and I mean for the past couple of weeks in China, it's called Dota Babies. And for those who are not familiar with that, it's directly, the key heroes in the game are direct rip-off of Dota, Defense of the Ancient, which is a Valve game on PC. We published the game in China, Dota 2, and literally the game a few weeks after came out. Now it's making a lot of money on mobile on its own, but there's absolutely no copyright, no IP, they haven't signed it, and they just took all the characters and ported them over their mobile games. So to Tina's point, like, they move really, really quickly. So you do want to have a local partners that could secure that as well. Because it's still possible, even in China, to go to Apple and to claim copyright infringement. But Apple China is very careful of checking as well with local authorities that, you know, could this copyright be claimed in the local territories? And I think if you are an American developer, you never will get this enforced. So this is where local partners matter.
When I was still marketing apps, the record that I saw was one of the games that I worked with was 2 hours. It took 2 hours for it to hit the US store before it was already had 1,600 downloads in China, and they were like, I'm sorry, what?
We actually advised a partner on entering the China market, and they had something like 8 to 10 million illegal downloads of their game. But the way that's set up is, if you find a Chinese partner that can do this with you, like, that represents a user base that's actually interested in your game. And if you go to the distribution channels, they will do an update of your game, and you can swap in the real version. But again, that requires doing the distribution deal and sort of having a local partner.
I think an interesting point too is that we always said about localization, right? And no one ever defines what that really means. And I think the general consensus of, oh, localization, I just need to change the language of the game or the text of the game to the localized language. But I think, like with AppFlood or with a lot of Western publishers, the gameplay and the mechanics have to be tweaked too to the audience. And I don't think a lot of people understand that when you talk about localization.
Yeah. But I mean, one point there though, if you look again, looking a lot at the Chinese market tonight, but if you look at the top grossing game in China, especially on iPad, you're looking at about 6 or 7 Western games. Hearthstone is doing great, Clash of Clans is doing great, One Beach is doing great, and so on and so forth. Infinity Warrior 3 is making, you know, is in the top 20 grossing for Glue. You have as well like a bunch of the Game Love games who are doing really well. So I think the localization, culturalization, people tend to think, oh, I need to do a lot of adjustments. You're seeing a lot more Western hits going there with just, you know, the same version as the US, but, you know, then often like local partnership as well.
I want to open it up for questions in just a second, and then now I'm going to hand it over to you.
No, I was going to say, you're absolutely right. It 100% depends on the game. You know, like for Half-Brits games that are more casual and probably need to be tweaked, but like Clash of Clans perfectly caters to an Asian audience.
Any questions in the audience thus far? We kind of jump around. Yes, sir? Is
been a lot of talk about China, it's a big market, but what do you see our success things to do when you're from Africa, South America, Middle East, other areas where people pay a lot of stuff for mobile, like the ad rates in Africa are just crazy because people buy stuff with their phones. So what are the things you see in those areas that work besides big hits and some best practices, your games you've seen that done well or apps?
Being the country where the US troops are, because they do spend a lot of money in games. Apparently we're correlating like some of the Middle East countries where the size of the US Army is present there, and it really helps if you want to monetize some of the trading card games.
I'd say those markets are also very different because a lot of people don't own credit cards in those markets, so you're not going to be able to sell through the same way. You might have to put up a subscription service so that. And then there's a lot of prepaid cards and things like that. So just to take advantage of those differences in the markets around payments and make sure that your game lines up with how those markets work.
There's another thing, which is that the preponderance in Africa in particular is still feature phones. So smartphones are less penetrated. So your game generally needs to be a little bit less the requirements on memory and so on.
Focus specifically on Northern Africa for a second, but I would also say just taking a look, because the trends there change so quickly and they are so different from the rest of the world, taking a very close look at the top trending, top downloaded games, because more so than almost anywhere else, they change. And the trends that you see there are almost kind of fascinating if you just watch them. And just to you know, take a close look there and you can see you know, what are these guys doing that are different. Other questions? Hold on a second.
How much is a carry, a mobile carry, on the monetized part of the equation for distributions?
Can you repeat the question? Sorry.
The mobile carry, yes, at distributions. Is it still a factor right now in China or in other country?
So they're definitely still a factor, predominantly in Latin America, actually. We find that carrier deals are still really important as our OEM deals. So when you're looking at distribution in Latin America, actually getting onto the carrier's deck is still important, and you need to pay attention to it. In China, the carrier app stores are sort of one among many. One of the things that you need to keep in mind is that payment, in particular in China, is often carrier dependent. So you'll load your app into a certain app store, and that app store may have its own payment system, or it may require you to have a payment SDK from whether it's China Mobile or somewhere else. It just depends on the particular distribution channel that you choose. The other thing that's very specific to China is that in China, actually, most of the revenue that's transacted via AP is not via carrier billing, it's via SMS billing. So most of this is a minor thing, but the way that most people in China download their games is actually via their PC and onto their phone because bandwidth is relatively expensive. And so most of those games are done via SMS billing. So again, it comes back to this partnership thing where you need to work with somebody in the market that has an SMS billing gateway that allows you to charge for your IP.
And in the US, you could not care less about AT&T, Verizon, and the rest because we've tried it, and again, it's very low in traffic and it's very low in quality. So, you know, you could just spare yourself the pain of trying to go in the store. We're talking about less than 100 installs a day. So at this point, you know, rather like, go and talk to other people.
Yes. All right, moving on.
How will games change? How will the marketplace change? You know, fast games and small games, on Blast or on a much more.
So, I'd like one of the things that's starting to get to me a little bit with the wearables is people sort of always talking about the blue sky thing. So I can talk about blue sky. You know, it's going to change everything. You know, left and right. Unfortunately, I think to this point, it really is still kind of an open field.
hard to predict. That's kind of the fun of a part of my job of doing developer relations is I get to go and talk to a lot of these companies that are doing amazing things, and you put something out there, and people come up with just surprisingly sort of clever ideas. So, like I said, right now, you know, we're sort of dealing with some of the basic things that you'd expect. I mean, the kinds of sensors that you have in these devices. You know, there's the straightforward, you've got an accelerometer. Okay, now I can do something interesting where, you know, I can track my hand motion in some way. And I can combine that with something else. You know, I can do a game on TV, or, you know, if it's like multi-screen, you can be doing stuff all over the place. But I think the real interesting stuff, you know, there's a lot to flesh out there, so I wouldn't kind of downplay that, but I think there's going to be some real surprises yet to come too. So.
You know what I can guarantee is we'll be showing you ads on wearables.
The ads will now be put onto all of your devices. Other questions?
I work for a mobile payments company, so we always deal with mobile carriers and know the constraints for that, but one of our biggest things that we encounter is localization of pricing. So I just wanted to see if your opinions on types of pricing of apps that are traditionally $5 or higher in the US and how the pricing changes from Latin America to North Africa to Asia and so on.
Ours are usually $1, and I think since games are basically premium, I guess you have that problem with IAP packs, so you might need to manage that a little bit better. But for the most part, you know, we came from a premium background where ours were maybe $1, but that's changed a lot. We took all of our games free recently, except for Free Ninja. So, and that's really allowed us to move, but yeah, that's something that we haven't thought about, different pricing for different regions for IAP.
When I used to work in the Facebook space, Facebook games, it made complete sense to localize price points depending on the geographic location. But what tended to happen was these people would come together in the forums, or they would somehow figure out that someone in Brazil is getting the same thing for a third of the price than someone in the US was. And the people in the US who were paying a premium for it would freak out because they're now at a competitive disadvantage. So I think it makes very much sense to do so, but you have to worry about your game community too, and figuring it out and offending some of the people that are paying the premium price points.
It's one of those things that works really well when you first start out, and then as your community gets bigger and bigger and they start talking more and more, you run into that problem.
I mean, the key issue for core games is piracy, right? Like, if I could literally get your $99 package for like 50 euros or 100 RMB in China, then I'm going to go and sell back my account. And, you know, literally, like, until you catch people doing that, which is not easy in this, you know, space, then you have a huge issue in terms of revenue, because you have people getting for $50 or $40 what they should have been paying $99 for. So I do think right now a lot of developers, including the very big ones, are doing the one size fits all, and you have one pricing that just go, you know, across the countries and just convert to local currency, eventually add VAT on the top of it. You have a bunch of European countries receiving VAT on the top, and that's it. So it's not very, you know, subtle like some of the retailers. If you look at Walmart, Carrefour, and the rest for worldwide, really adapt to the local markets, right? Their pricing, even for items that are the same in every store, but I don't think we're there yet. Hopefully, a couple of years, but only when will I figure a way to block the fact that people transfer account, which might not be tomorrow.
So I'm going to have time for one more question, and because you've all been so patient, we'll open the bar back up, but I believe you had a question earlier?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's a general question to the guy who wants to find out, what device are you wearing?
And that's our final question, ladies and gentlemen.
Sorry, just joking.
Yeah, you'll have to pardon me to like take her off someplace and slap her for what she just said. Sorry.
It's all right.
No, I know. It is not.
My money's on her.
No, it's.
Damn.
Yeah. You're probably right. I'm sorry about that.
It's all right.
No, this is year two. And so actually, wow, I get to do a plug. Thank you for being here. So actually, we are here talking about our app challenge for developing apps for the year two device. Lots of money, great opportunities. Come over and check it out and talk to some of my favorite people over here that are working in our booth. And yeah, that's what it is. And that leads me perfectly into the final things that I want to ask is just the two biggest takeaways that you would want developers to have in regards to launching and committing on the Android ecosystem, and any final thoughts that you have in hot takes, CPU, and
I'll really put on the spot here.
Yeah.
Two things.
Can't be one, can't be three.
I think the really important thing if you're launching on Android is the global footprint you get with being on Android. So if you're gonna launch something, localize it for the markets that make sense for Android, right? So I think that's the biggest thing about going with Android. And secondly, I would look at something that's building on something that you can go cross-platform with very easily, i.e. Unity. You know, it makes it really easy to build on multiple platforms. So those are two things that I would keep in mind.
It's the fun part about sitting right next to me is you get the first round of questions. And then
I would say it's really important to think about the new game services that Google is offering. So if you use those game services, you're much more likely to get featured, much more likely to be your friend. So I'd say that would be the top things. And that also saves you a lot of trouble having to build that out yourself. So check out what Google has in terms of game services and use them. We certainly do. Sorry, I'm going to break the rule. That's going to be my sort of top one thing. The localization.
I stole from it. Yeah, it's fine. I'm a scapegoat.
Yeah. So, certainly from kind of the Samsung perspective, I think we're looking at a lot of kind of the convergence aspect, and I think this is an area where you can actually make a real difference in your games potentially and get some notice because it's going to be really radically different in some sense. So if you're doing something that's connecting like, a tablet to a TV or, adding in the wearables in that aspect, then that's a bit more of an open field right now in a lot of ways. So that's the easy one for me to say. Of course, that's a little bit of a different, I don't know what I'm trying to say. I don't know. I'm not expecting to get prompt buy-in from everyone here, but cross-platform, I think that's something that you are going to see cross-platform moving to beyond just mobile and tablet and things like that too. So,
well, I think two things. Like the first, if you are content developers, you could make a lot of money developing content. Don't try to be a marketing agency. Don't try to be other things. And if you have a game that costed like $500,000 to $1 million to make, you have to have $500,000 to $1 million to market it. So, I'm still seeing a lot of developers who believe that with like $10,000-$50,000, they're gonna go very far in terms of user acquisition. Or just rely and then say, oh, please Google, Apple, feature me. And that's their only hope. And they spend 2 years developing great games, but that's it. So if you don't know how to market your games, then trust other people to do so. Same as like if you don't know Asian markets, trust other people to publish there for you. That's one thing. The other thing is, I hope there is a few core gamers around here. Look at Asia. Korea, China, and now Japan is getting in the top 25 grossing, something like 40 to 50% of core gaming apps. It's not the case yet in the West. I'm saying yet because you could imagine that there is core gamers with smartphones or tablets, but they just haven't found the right products yet. So I think the market is really ripe to get more core gaming content on the platform. And you don't have to be Blizzard to be a big hit on this platform. You just need to provide games that actually meet the core gamers' requirement. It costs some money to develop, but I think there is still a lot of very open space versions out there, you know. So I think if you're great at making core games, think about this platform. There is still a lot of resistance in the Western studios, whereas if you look at Korea, China, or even now Japan, they're like, sure, mobile is a gaming platform. I'm going to develop a core games for it. So I hope Western developers open their eyes and stop being like, oh, it's just Microsoft and Sony and that's it.
Wow, that's an awesome segue for what I wanted to say. So if you have chosen to develop on Android, you've chosen a platform that really gives you access to these markets that no one is thinking about, but that are really, really huge. And whether you have a moderate level of success or you have a large level of success with your game, you are going to have a lot of traffic in places like China and Japan and Korea. And just what I would say to you is there are options for monetizing that traffic. And we're one of them. We'd love to talk to you. It might not be on the front of your radar today, but it should be. And you know, whole teams here ready to chat with you about that and how to make money there.
Cool. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for our awesome panel tonight. We're gonna be around here till 10 p.m.